This episode of Key Radio Book Club will contain some triggering topics. We will be talking about child abuse, we will be talking about bullying, and we will be talking about injuries from said abuse. So if those are triggering topics for you, might want to steer clear of this one. Otherwise, enjoy Key Radio Book Club. Good evening, and welcome to Key Radio Book Club. Hello, Scout. You made it.
Hi. Yes, I did. It's the surprise return of me.
We were, I mentioned this last week on the episode you haven't listened to yet, because you haven't finished that route yet.
Unfortunately, because biggest Sasami fan here, finally getting to read her route.
Yeah, but I'm like, I think he's gonna make it. But I'm not sure. But you're here, so.
Yeah, it's we none of us for sure. It seemed like I exited the book club for, you know, the podcast for this book club. But just like in Little Busters itself, I've come back after Refrain has been finished.
True. Yes, that is a thing that happens in this game, and that's why we're doing three freaking episodes even after the true route. Because my God, this game is a mess. Even though I love it. So we are going to talk about Kanata route tonight, but we've got a couple of other things first while I have Scout here specifically. We're going to dive deep into the mini games. Now, we talked about most of these on the Common Route episode. However, we were not able to talk about their thematic cohesion within Little Busters, but now that we are allowed to spoil Refrain, we can get into it. So, Scout is currently the record holder for the baseball combo. So it's only fitting that we have you here right now.
Yes, and I'm on every other leaderboard, too. Like, I out of everyone who's participated in this book club, I've probably gone the most crazy with the minigames. So.
Are you the only one on all four?
Not the only one, but...
No, you and Nari, though. There are only two people on all four leaderboards.
But, yeah, okay, where do I start? So, you know, obviously, Little Busters has minigames. We've talked about that. And obviously, I don't think we've gone on, like, gathering opinions on this, but I think it's reasonable that a lot of people who read this either... didn't try the mini games at all or quit them after the first run.
So. I think that is actually the most common thing, is to leave them on only for the first run.
Yeah, because they're interesting at first, but let's be honest, they are
they
not
get in the way.
You. I wouldn't
get
say
in the
that,
way.
But whether you feel that or not, they're also just they are difficult to get into. Every
yes.
one of them has issues on your first playthrough. Riki is extremely weak in the battle rankings, and he can beat a few of the people like Komari or Kud, but he has almost no chance against Kyosuke or Kengo. In the batting practice, you just don't know what to do. You don't know how to combo easily. You don't know how to control yourself. You're barely going to get hits off to begin with, and even if you do combo with people, it's usually only going to be Kyosuke or Kurugaya. And the baseball game. I mean, it's a disaster. You don't even have Kengo on your team. It's just there's almost no feasible way to win it on your first playthrough.
Boy, I forgot we have to talk about that thing, too.
Yes, it's just, it is frustrating. Yeah. It's very understandable if people go through that and they decide, I don't want to deal with this anymore.
Right.
But here's the thing. Here is why we're talking about this. Here is the thematic significance in that. I think that is 100% intended. That feeling of frustration,
totally
of hopelessness.
Agree. Yes,
just
totally agree.
Just the feeling that you can't do this right, that you're never going to get to the top. That is exactly how Riki feels. Riki is weak at the start. He has no confidence in himself. He's pessimistic. Kyosuke handing off all these responsibilities to him is like, it's never going to work out. And it seems like that's exactly how it goes. But then you start finishing routes. And things, if you continue with these minigames, things start getting easier. Rin and Riki start getting stronger. Rin goes from having almost no chance beating Sasami to being able to defeat her almost effortlessly. Everyone starts getting better stat growths. Riki, it actually becomes possible for him to beat Kengo and Kyosuke to get to the top of the leaderboards. And, I mean, batting practice doesn't necessarily become any easier, but with more experience, it becomes more possible to get things going.
It also generally becomes more exciting because, like, the most obvious, like, change from route to route is Rin is learning new types of pitches.
Yes.
Which just gets more fun to see, like, what crazy things she learned how to do, and also what ridiculous name Kyosuke comes up with for it.
The reaction they have to the true raging Meow Ball is such a classic.
It's so clever. It's really fun.
It breaks Masato and Kyosuke's minds completely.
Yeah.
But yeah, just as you go through the route, as you see the inner strength that Riki has, it starts becoming outer strength as well, both for him and Rin. That's an important thing. Rin is also affected by this. She and Riki, by the end of, like, by the time you're in the post-game like this, Riki and Rin are the strongest people on the baseball team. Straight up, Riki can very consistently get infield home runs. And there's
right.
The question of why, you know, why does this happen? So refrain
and
shows.
The reason is because it needs to, in a few words.
Yes, because as Refrain explicitly shows, all of these missions, all of these minigames, they are coming from Kyosuke for the purpose of trying to strengthen Riki and Rin. That's why they're always at the center of them. It's for their sakes. And of course, it doesn't go well at first. But as they grow, bit by bit, as they get stronger, they do. They get a lot more possible. Kyosuke can even break out his Mask the Saito persona and challenge Riki in at his full strength. And if Riki wins that, suddenly it's become something much grander. He's not just the strongest of the little busters. He's the strongest in the school. And yeah, even the baseball game becomes possible. And when you pull it off, genuinely, when I won it the first time, I was as happy as Kyosuke was.
How many times did it take you to play the final baseball game before you finally won?
Four. I finished like three routes, and it was when I was doing Rin 1 that I won it the first time. So
got it.
But that's because I just really got invested in these mini games.
Yeah. Like, did you do any save scumming for it, or just?
Not
for
the baseball game, but I did beat Saito then too, and I save scummed for that.
Yeah.
But it was still possible, and you know what? It may not matter to the story, but pulling those things off is an accomplishment. There is a feeling of satisfaction to it And that is why I think the implementation and the pacing of these minigames is brilliant.
Wow.
Because it
okay.
follows Riki and Rin's character development so well. It seems impossible for them at first. But bit by bit, as they get stronger, as they keep trying at it, it gets easier, it gets more possible, becomes something they can do. And when you finally pull it off, it is a genuine accomplishment that only happened because you tried, because you didn't give up halfway through, because you kept putting in all that effort until it finally happened. And as should be obvious to anyone who got this far into Little Busters, that is like the whole theme of it. The theme of the routes, the theme of the story. Be strong, be willing to take on those challenges, and don't just give up. And
yes,
I mean, I'll say this, Little Busters is probably the first visual novel I've read where I was really like trying to examine the themes and understand them as I was first going through it. And from that perspective, playing the minigames actually increased my understanding
really,
of that so
like,
much more.
Strengthens it, yes.
Yeah, so for, you know, how the minigames actually play, obviously that is going to be a matter of debate, but for how they tie into the themes of the story, for how they further invest you in just what it's trying to say, I think these just deserve a 10 out of 10.
What I want to add to this is that one thing we talk about in Key a lot as a whole is their happy endings. And a lot of people, like, not going to name specific works, obviously, but a lot of people, like, complain about the happy endings from this company. But this one, I would argue, is one of, if not the most earned, because of the fact that you, the player, actually are working for it. Now, obviously, for the sake of convenience, these mini games are made optional. But the thing I like to always think about is that even if you, the player, are skipping them, Riki can't. So, like, Riki is still going to baseball practice every day, whether or not you are actually playing the baseball practice. He is going through all these things. There's one specific choice. Who do I want to train with today? That, in the common route, that happens regardless of whether you're playing the game or not. You know, I think the reason the mini games are made optional more than anything else is just for the sake of accessibility, because, you know, you are trying to appeal to visual novel readers, a lot of whom want to skip the gameplay, which I completely understand, but it is definitely worth thinking about how the gameplay ties in with everything that happens here, and that you have to work for it.
Yeah, exactly. Like, for anyone who may have skipped them on their first read, if you ever go back for a reread, I really do recommend giving these games more of a try.
Absolutely.
You may succeed or you may not, but as long as you try, I think it really does help immerse you into the message of Little Busters that much more. You'll never accomplish it if you don't try at all, and you may surprise yourself. Just like Riki. Like, I never once thought I would get so good at batting practice.
But yeah, to get the top spot on the leaderboards, which, like, I'll talk about this in a second, but finish. Like, because I have a story about this.
I was just going to say, like, I've almost become, like, the mentor for people who've been struggling with batting practice. Like, I've been passing off whatever advice I can just because, I don't know, when you come to the right understanding, you can do a lot more than you think at first. So, yeah, even if you don't think it's possible at first, you'll never know unless you try. And just, that is
absolutely
a beautiful thing, I think.
Yes. I want to, just for a minute, let's travel back in time 2 years to Summer Pockets Book Club. I did something similar for the prize packs in that book club where I gave away a couple of prize packs for high scores in ping pong. And shout outs to Cold. He held the top spot in both of those for the entire 2 month book club. No one dared to challenge him. Scout didn't do that. Like, Laser held the top spot for, like, I think about 4 or 5 weeks. And Scout was like, yo, Lucci, bet. I'll read whatever crappy game you make me read unless I can get this. Like, and it ended up being a really good motivator, and you took that top spot.
It was literally the day after I made that bet with you.
Oh, really?
Yes, I looked. And that wasn't even, like, my first record. That was, like, 22. And then a few days later, I got 25, like, almost by accident.
Yes, so that's the record right now, by the way, is 25. I don't think I've seen anyone get higher than that, but like in my history of playing this game, but you have one more week if you're going to try and dethrone Scout. Like,
I welcome the challenge, but no, I won't go down without a fight.
Yeah, real. But like, my point in bringing this up is that, like, the motivation to actually, like, get that top spot has been a lot more fun to watch this book club. Like, it's just, you know,
I have the perfect motivator, a Sasami prize pack.
It's true. Sasami is wonderful. And you're about, what, halfway through that route? You'll get to really see it soon.
I'm so, like, excited.
Yes. So, just to give a couple of shout-outs, like, within the mini-games, we should talk about Mask the Saito, because we didn't get, like, deep into him at all.
Oh, yeah. I did mention him a bit earlier, but he deserves expansion on that.
Yes, this is one of the problems I talked about in the Common Route episode, is that this is story content that is locked behind the mini-games, which, like, from an accessibility perspective, I do think that is kind of a problem. But if you're actually gonna go for it, it is really freaking funny.
It's fantastic. But for anyone who doesn't know the requirements, you have to get Riki to the top of the leaderboards before Kyosuke resets his position, which, speaking of which, that's also a brilliant little detail. Kyosuke will not just let Riki stay at the top forever. Whatever his position is, at some point Kyosuke will go, let's change things up a bit, and place him to the very bottom. Whether he was at the top, he was like fourth place, whatever, he's straight to the bottom. And that's like a challenge. That's Kyosuke saying, you have to climb your way back up now if you want to fight me at my full potential, basically. And if you do that, then yeah, that's exactly what happens. He goes full Mask the Saito. He starts demolishing everyone in your path, unless you're good at batting practice like I am, in which case some people can beat him, but eventually he'll make his way up to Riki, and it's the big fight. This is literally Kyosuke, like, twice as strong as he is normally.
Yes, like, and there's the problem that, like, is Mask the Saito actually Kyosuke, though? Like,
I don't know, it's a bit hard to say.
I do think it's funny that, like, the cast of the Little Busters is able to figure out that Haruka and Kanata are twins much easier than they're able to figure out that Mask the Saito is Kyosuke.
Riki isn't fooled, okay?
No, and nobody is, like, really fooled, but I think, like, because of what we know about Refrain, everyone has to play along with the rules of this world, you know?
Now, or they just play along for the sake of it, which I believe, too.
It could be either one. I actually, like, in one of my very early runs of this game, he actually lost to Kud, and I never got to fight him.
Like, I saw that too, actually.
Which I just think is really funny, because, like, he got a really bad roll, and then Kud got both of the dogs. Which I mean, just decimate.
For me, the first time I saw him, his opponent was Kurugaya, and I saved Skumped a bit just to see if it was possible. But after she beat him once, she then beat him like three times in a row. He got absolutely screwed.
Yeah.
But, you know, in a way, I like
that. He's not invincible. Like,
yeah.
Which is, again, a plot point in Refrain about Kyosuke, and that he's not always right, you know?
Yeah, like,
Nari and Empy and I talked about that at length.
Even in the baseball game, like, this is a point I forgot when I was saying that, but the first time you're playing the baseball game, likely the only good players you have are Kyosuke and Kurugaya, who are, like, they're the mentors, so of course, you know?
Makes sense.
If you get a point, it's probably going to be from them, but as you start getting better, as you start pumping up everyone else, they stay useful, but they're no longer, like, the clutch. They're no longer the crutches. They just have their own roles now. Like, Kyosuke is an all-rounder, but Riki can outdo him at that. Kurugaya is very fast, but she's not a good enough hitter to get off hits that aren't at risk of being caught. You have
right.
to play them to their strengths, and you have to work as a team. You can't just rely on them, which is brilliant, I think.
Yes. Everything ties together, and, like, that's one of the special things about this story.
It really is.
I got one more thing to bring up related to the minigames. I mentioned in the disclaimer at the beginning of the episode, we will be talking about child abuse today, which is a very serious topic, but there's one other topic that's not as serious that we need to talk about. Rin engages in animal abuse in these minigames.
So one particular event that happens in between all the fights with Sasami is Kyosuke sends Rin into the school at night because of some mysterious animal that is, like, terrorizing everyone. And this is, even more so than Sasami or the baseball game, this is a very hard event to do correctly. Rin is very likely to lose, and it's more like that Kyosuke Kengo or Masato will have to step in to beat it for her. But if you beat that animal on the first night, it turns out to be an entire subplot. It goes on
It's so hidden and so ridiculous. Like, most people, I feel like, don't, like, if you lose once, it basically ends the story. And
yeah,
most,
like,
people just kind of want to get a move on.
Even that first night, like, even if Kengo or Masato beat it, that's it. Like, you're not going to see anything else. It's just replaced by more Sasami fights. But no, it goes on for three nights if you do win with Rin. And it's like,
yeah,
it turns out the animal in question was, like, genetically modified by the science club or something. Well, one of the nutty clubs that belongs to this cursed school. And suddenly it's like, it's no longer a monster. Rin has to take it down to save it from being a monster. And it also turns out it's an animal that Kyosuke had met in his travels that followed him back to the school.
Shout outs to how this sequence is handled in the anime, by the way, which I know you haven't seen yet, Scout. But the fact that, like, it's in the anime at all is just really funny, and I love how it's handled. I love how it's, like, worked into the main story. Nari explained it. They tied the Trial of Courage and the mysterious life form into one episode, which is just, honestly, kind of perfect. Like, I'm glad they're separate in the visual novel when you have more time, but if you're pressed for time and you're combining things together, those go together quite well, you know, because school at night, things are just completely ridiculous.
Yeah, that is a good point.
So that's the Common Route minigames. Anything else to add?
I should say, it doesn't stop at the bird that you see the first time.
Oh,
there's
yeah.
three different animals ending with an Asian black bear, and it gets it gets ridiculously hard. I don't think it's even possible if you don't, like, hand off Rin, like, good items from the battle rankings. But it is surprisingly satisfying if you do pull it off, because it's not just, like, hunting down a monster or anything now. It's saving an innocent animal that had taken a liking to Kyosuke and, like, keeping it from being killed, basically. Which is, like...
I don't know that I ever finished the one with the bear.
I've
gotten past the bird. I forgot what's next, but I've gotten up to the bear.
I forget what it is, too, but... Yeah, I don't know. Even that fits into the themes, because it's like, you can lose, and Rin will be fine, but if you do, that animal is just, it's gonna be put down. You're fighting to save its life, and it's not gonna happen if you don't try your hardest.
One thing that we mentioned a lot, Empy and I, on both of the Rin episodes, is that all of the tasks Rin gets from Lennon are about just helping others, and this really just fits right in with that as well. And just, you know, like, that's the way to get Rin out of her shell, but it's not just people too, it's the animal buddies as well.
It is. It's a frustrating subplot, but in hindsight, even that's really smart.
It's fun if you like grinding.
Seriously, this is just, like, one of the most thematically rich stories I've ever seen. Reading this from the perspective of dissecting those themes as I went on was just fantastic.
It's really fun. And, like, man, it's... There's so much.
But speaking of dissecting, I guess it's about time we get to Kanata.
Yes, let's get to Kanata. I mentioned a little bit in the Key Radio channel that I have to issue an apology. So I don't know if Platy is not in the audience now, but they will probably be listening on the YouTube version. But I have to say it. On the Sasami episode, I had said that I really like the themes of Sasami Route, but it is the worst written route in the game. I apologize for that, because that was wrong. This is the worst written route in the game. My God, I've got a lot of problems with the presentation in Kanata Route, but the themes are still really good, and I love the heroine, so it's still good.
We're already going like this. All right.
This is how this episode is going to be. It's not going to be like Mio.
I've accepted my role in this episode.
You are in for it today.
I've accepted I'm alone in this. I'm going to be fighting against everyone else on this.
Here's the thing, though. I don't think you're actually alone in this. This is a divisive route, but it's not like a universally disliked one by any means. You know, like... Here's the thing about Kanata, like, just going back to Haruka Route, Kanata herself is a very divisive character, so more than any other route in the game, this one needed to be good, because most people are not necessarily sold on the heroine. Sasami is, like, basically a meme for the majority of her screen time in the main game, but Kanata does some legitimately terrible things in Haruka Route. Now, we know, because it's one of the themes of the game, that good intentions is a thing here, you know? Like, you and I talked about this in Mio's route, and it comes up in Haruka, and it comes up in Refrain. So,
even
like,
in Kud,
yes.
Her belief, there is no one intentionally evil in this world. It is one of the themes of Little Busters.
Right. So, like, we know that based on the things we learned in Kanata Route, but that's not necessarily going to be a sell for everyone. We needed to learn some new things about Kanata in this route that change that perspective, and I just don't think we get enough of it. Is the bulk of my issues with this one. So we'll get into it as we go through the story, but, like, overall, like, I've got problems.
Yeah, I mean, that's fair. I don't agree on not getting enough, but I'll also admit I went into this after rereading Kud Route with Kanata as her roommate, bitch. Can we just discuss that for a bit?
We talked about it already, but on the Kud Route episode, but we can get into how it's relevant here, sure.
Yeah, so... Yeah, when... Okay, well, first off, when you get Kanata as Kud's roommate, it doesn't seem like a great choice. There's a scene that happens with all of her roommates where she's just where Kud is just standing in the hall waiting to give them their keys to the room. With Mio and Haruka, obviously it goes just fine. But Kanata does not really take to it. She doesn't like the keychains that come with it. She just kind of brushes them off, even though Kud is really attached to them. And eventually she just grudgingly accepts one of Potato from Air, which is another random reference I never expected.
I forgot about that, but yes, that is the thing that happens.
It looks like a cotton ball with eyes, and it says Pico Pico. It's literally Potato. It yes. caught me off guard almost as much as the Master.
Yeah, like...
But yeah, it seems like a questionable choice at first, but then you get into the route, and you see the choices that... the scenes that come from Kanata being the roommate. And she's actually a really good roommate to Kud. She's a bit distant as it's her nature. But as we can see, she still knows Kud really well. She becomes like practically her best friend out of the Little Busters. If you choose to study with her, she has some critiques on how Kud takes tests and stuff. But they're very valid. It's like her mind wanders. She doesn't always pay attention to where she fills things in, which can screw her over in one of the bad endings if you have a particular roommate combination.
Yeah.
Like, there are things that she only notices because she's already so close to Kud and pays attention. And it's just like that her friendship with Kud is like one of the most... Seeing that friendship with Kud is like where my opinion on Kanata really started to turn around, because shocker, it's really hard to like Kanata from Haruka Route.
Yeah, and that's, trust me, we'll definitely be getting into the relationship with her and Kud when we talk about a certain bad end shortly.
Yeah.
But like, the thing is with Kanata, the reason she is the way she is and the reason she's so hated by a lot of people in the game, like the reason a lot of the other characters are annoyed with her is because no one really listens to her. But as we notice with Kud, one of her biggest virtues is that Kud is an incredible listener. So I think that the two of them are in some ways actually kind of perfect for each other. And yeah. It's also just more, you know, like I say this every route she's in, whether she's the heroine or not, how good is Kud in this route?
Like, it's incredible.
Freaking amazing character. I love her so much.
She is the best. I am impatiently waiting for Kud Wafter.
Oh yes. Like, oh, and it side note, if you're a Kud fan, man, you've got a lot to look forward to when that translation drops. It's a very good game.
But yeah, after I finished Refrain, I had just like been hunting around for scenes with Kanata like that, because I had seen almost nothing about her. I had missed like everything with her in the actual routes that wasn't just Haruka. But as I saw that, I started seeing the good side to her. I was converted even before I read her route. I think that's the thing about Kanata. It's not that her good qualities don't exist, but you have to dig really deep to find them sometimes.
Yes. The other thing is that, like, I have to give a shout out to Will and Wish here.
Because oh, yes, yes, I was going to mention this too.
When you get her first, like, new scene in the common route, like, Will and, unlike Cat Glass and the Round Moon, you will not hear Will and Wish pre-refrain at all. It is not possible to get that theme. You only get it in her first new scene after refrain, and, like, the reaction is always, wait, this is Kanata's theme? This doesn't seem to fit. But, like, the farther you get, the more you realize that Will and Wish is really just saying one thing. give her a chance.
Yes, you know? I have so much to say about this song and this first new scene with Kanata, but...
Right.
Like, let's get into it.
Like, okay, so now's as good a time as any.
Just the way this first scene is set up is perfect, because it's not even technically new. It's a scene you've seen many times before. It's Kanata passing by Riki and Haruka in the hallway with all her prefects. And, you know how it's always supposed to go. Kanata doesn't give them the time of day, and Haruka is left, irritated by the sight of her. But then something different happens. She stops in place, and she looks at Riki and Haruka, and Riki is just completely caught off guard, and he's left wondering, is this a look of hostility, or is this a look of friendliness? And that alone is, like, the most brilliant lead-up into Kanata's route I think could even be.
It is the best first choice, like, that you can have for this.
It's like, I think both the reaction of Riki and the player is the same, because it's like, why would you expect friendliness from this? You know how this is supposed to go, or at least you think how it's supposed to go. But if you choose hostility, everything goes back to how it is normally. She goes back to her chillier self, and Haruka goes back to just being
not to mention
by her.
The song immediately cuts off. This is something that Nari had pointed out.
Immediately it fades out, and everything is back. Everything is as you think it should be. But if you take that chance, if you decide that she might be giving a look of friendliness and you choose that, it continues, and Haruka is completely caught speechless by it. And just like that, things have changed. Kanata keeps showing up throughout the common route now, getting scenes with Haruka and Kud and other people, and she is different. She and Haruka are talking now. That scene with Kud giving her the key is so much friendlier now. She accepts it with no complaint. The scene with Komari on the lawn, where she normally just scolds the shit out of her, she's so much gentler about it. She is turning over a new leaf, basically. And it's like the most unexpected but pleasant thing I could have even been met with. Here.
Now, something we can say, because this is a post-refrain route, is that, like, first of all, let's get this out of the way. I do believe that the Kanata we see, if you choose that choice, is the real Kanata, who was brought into the dream, and that we can talk about who the dreamer is later.
I have plenty to say on this, but yeah, we'll save that for later.
Yeah, but the other thing that's important to note here is that this, not only is this the real Kanata, but this is Kanata, wanting to kind of make amends for how she treated Haruka in the real world.
Yes,
because the Kanata we get in Haruka route is how Haruka views her. Not necessarily everything we know, and like something that we couldn't talk about then is that Kyosuke did happen to know everything at the time, because he is obviously now to us the one who put up the posters telling everyone of everything. He's the only one with the motive and the knowledge to do that. So yeah, that's a thing that is, worth mentioning here, because Kanata is not as evil as Haruka believed her to be, and I think, yes, it is somewhat self-inflicted on Kanata's part, but this is her chance to kind of, redeem herself.
Yes, this is her when she's dropping the mask for basically the first time outside of Haruka's ending.
Yes.
And yeah, to just backtrack just a bit, Will and Wish, since we mentioned it.
Yeah.
I mean, you already said what it represents. Give me a chance. But let's just break that down a bit deeper. It starts as just a just a piano piece.
Yep.
Similar to approaching the light, but in this case, it sounds... I'd describe it as colder, as having a distant feeling to it. It's not a friendly tune, but it sounds collected and calm. Just like Kanata, she might not be vitriolic normally, but that doesn't mean she's your friend, or at least she's not trying to be your friend most of the time. But then the second part starts up, and the tune changes, and it sounds just completely different. There's a sense of...
winds and strings are added.
Yes, it's like... I would describe it as longing. It sounds lonely now. It sounds like someone is trying to reach out for something precious. This is how Kanata feels in the inside. This is what she is feeling underneath that coldness. And finally, you get to the third part, which is the piano again, like the first part, but with, I think they're violins, right?
Yep.
With
a whole string orchestra, all the strings
yes.
under it.
And with those added, again, like approaching the light, the whole sound of the theme changes. It sounds warm, I'd say. It sounds
yep.
kind. It's a comfy tune now instead of a cold and lonely one. And that is what is also underneath Kanata. That is the person she is once you get past all of those outer layers. And this is like, this is my favorite character theme in Little Busters now. It was approaching the light, but this one is, I think, even more brilliant.
I think mine too, honestly. Like, if we're not counting second themes, like only one magic word, it's Will and Wish. Like
it's
this,
just...
it's the way it changes your view on the character is just in its first, like, when you first hear it, it's something really special.
It's fantastic, and just Shinji Orito being a master, as usual.
Classic. Like, he hasn't stopped, you know? He's been with Key since the very beginning, and still is, like... So that's the opening. We kind of, you know... have gone through this common route type stuff. The way Riki gets involved with Kanata is really silly, where he's like going to help the dorm head out with stuff.
Oh,
so
yes, this
Kyosuke is basically using Riki as a bargaining chip.
Yes.
You know? Like,
we want to keep our club room, so go help. Go get some brownie points.
It's human trafficking at its best. Like, you know, let's call
it
what it
is. It should be said, for how much Kanata starts showing up in the common route after that, Riki doesn't interact with her much. He's always watching from a distance.
Well, yes, and I think it's in character for him because, like, Riki doesn't like to get involved with when things are going well. Like, he'll jump in if he thinks someone is being hurt, but, like, even though Kanata is standoffish, she is being helpful here. And since we know, like, from refrain that, like, your character growth maintains from route to route, Haruka's route has obviously already happened here. So I think even if Riki can't, like, exactly tell why, he can feel the difference in these interactions versus how they used to be.
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, even in Kud route, where you see Kanata at her friendliness, he admits at one point he just doesn't know how to get along with her. And I think that's also a factor. Like, even if he's not seeing her be as harsh, I think that initial aura from her is kind of still pushing him away from really wanting to get involved with her until
yes.
he starts helping with the dorm committee.
Right.
But once it starts, we see something very interesting. We've seen Kanata be so much kinder to everyone else. We've seen her basically making friends with the rest of the Little Busters, like Komari and Rin. But when she's alone with just Riki, she is acting much colder.
Has no interest whatsoever. I think this is actually really clever how this is set up.
Yes, I have so much to say about this. Like, I don't know if it's right now, but we can definitely talk about it when we get to the bad ending, whatever you want to bring that up.
I think, well, like, this is how you branch to the bad ending.
Yes.
So, like, it'll be, like, right around here. Riki gets a lot of outs throughout this entire sequence. Like, we've seen this with him before, that he has to be really persistent with a lot of the girls in order to, like, maintain a relationship with them. This is especially the case with Mio. But even more so with Kanata, because you actually get a lot of opportunities to get Riki out of here. And
it doesn't, it's not even something that should hurt him in story. It's instances where they're just alone and she's like, I can handle the work. You can just do whatever you want and it'll be fine.
Right. Like, you really have to commit him to Kanata in order to stay in this story. Which makes sense for a character who has her walls up. Like, this is something that I talked a little bit about in the Haruka Route podcast, but I'm gonna definitely, like, bring it up here, is that Kanata grew up learning that the way to solve your problems is by being a bitch. Like, this is what was taught to her from a young age. So getting around that, like, is going to take a lot of work, and it's why she acts the way she does a lot of the time, because she just doesn't know any better. And in order to teach her better, you kind of have to be persistent with her and say, hey, you can act like this, but I'm not going anywhere. I still want to help you. You know?
So, and that's how you take it.
That's kind of how I take Kanata's standoffishness, shall we say. Now, there is a key heroine on a later work that you haven't read yet that I think does this kind of thing a lot better. But it's still, like, I think it's well done here.
I also think it's well done, but for a different reason that ties into the greater story of this route.
Yeah, go for it.
Well, I mean, to say this, we can start on the bad ending, finally.
Okay,
so the bad ending that you discovered by complete accident.
This bad ending is weird because, like, it's, first of all, it's a very obvious choice to get off the route, but, like, what would normally happen is that, like, first of all, it kicks you to the common route bad end first. And most route bad ends that get you to this point just play the common route bad end with Masato and then kick you back to the title screen. This is the only time in the game where you will have the common route bad end and then have another scene happen after it. Now, you deeper discovery of this. Do you have to have Kud as the roommate for this to occur?
No.
And okay.
Yes, it should be said. This is basically Kanata reflecting on things in her room. It's the scene. And Kud is involved. But
well,
that
it
happens
is
because
her and Kud's room. Like, it uses the Kud's room BG.
Yes. So this is specifically happening within Kud's room, and she very explicitly, like, starts talking about her. She's even right next to her when it's happening.
Sleeping,
but
having
happens
a nightmare.
Yes, but this happens regardless of whether Kud is her roommate in this playthrough, you get it. And it's like, what Kanata is thinking about in her internal monologue during this is, there's a lot of things, but it starts with, a lot of people forget it, but having your wish granted does not always mean happiness.
I love that line.
Yes, it's a very abstract scene. But here is what I think is going on. As events later in the route put down, Kanata, this is a very complicated explanation I have for this, but this is seemingly happening after Haruka's route.
Interesting. Okay.
Because here is something. Okay, so Haruka's infamous bad ending, where Haruka is hit by a car.
Mm-hmm.
During that bad ending, Kanata, even when I was first reading it, I thought Kanata acted in a very suspicious way at times. She breaks down after she gets Riki into the clinic bed with her. Like, in a way that indicates she knows exactly what's going to happen, and she is completely remorseful over it. And secondly, when she is discussing with him in the rain why she was doing what she was doing in this route, when the ambulance passes that's going to Haruka, she starts crying and she says some very specific things. I don't want to see that flower of blood anymore. I don't want to smell blood anymore. You can't save her, so never get close to her again. Here is what I think, what Kanata's route especially told me. Kanata was part of the dream world of pre-refrain, and she was aware of it the entire time. In this bad ending, and even earlier,
I think I'm in the same place as you.
And even later in the route,
yes.
Kanata wakes up from a nightmare, and the first thing she checks is my hair wet? She talks about hating the rain later in the route for many reasons, but one of them specifically is she associates it with a pool of blood and with returning to being in her bed. Now, here is what something I think goes on implicitly. I do not think the routes, the loops in Little Busters that we personally see are the only ones that happen. I think
that is already confirmed, by the way.
Yes, but why I want to say that specifically is Kanata mentions that scene of that pool of blood, and she mentions seeing it over and over.
Yeah.
She has seen this bad end play out, and that's why she says what she says. That is why she breaks down crying even without having to see the scene of what happened to Haruka. Because she knows exactly what happened. She knows what this is going to result in, but she thinks there's no other way. She thinks she cannot be saved by Riki getting involved like this. And I think it's possible she was right, at least at first. I think it's possible Riki could have gone through any of these routes several times before he became strong enough to even get any of the good endings. It was like a Rin route situation, like, before that. And that
worth noting here, something that, like, strengthens what you're saying right now, Haruka route has the most failure points out of any non-refrain, non-Saya route in this game.
Yes, and even it has an interesting variation on the common bad ending, where you don't connect to Haruka, and you meet her outside the school gates, and then it just goes into that common route bad ending as he wonders if there was anything he could have done for her.
Right. Yep, that is a thing that happens.
So, and that explains Kut's presence in this bad ending as well, whether or not she's the roommate. I think this is just simply taking place in a loop where they are roommates and Kanata is just reflecting on it. Kanata goes up to Kud while she's having that nightmare, and she just reflects that no matter how much she wants to, she cannot save her from these nightmares. She can't help her, and she doesn't know who can.
The one thing I'm not positive about is that, like, does Kanata realize that she is in a dream related to the crash? That's the one thing I'm not positive about from this.
Should I say my just, like, final theory on where all of this is happening then?
Yeah, because, like, it's not going to come up much until we get to, like, the very end of the route when we're back in the real world.
So, yes, I think this is the original dream world that Kyosuke and everyone else had created. But more specifically, this is something that happens between Haruka's route being finished and her actually vanishing from the dream world, her exiting like everyone else besides Komari.
Because I'm pretty sure I agree with this, yeah.
There is one detail within Kud's route, again. There's the scene of Kud's just like being on the lawn with Riki and the dogs. Normally, Kanata comes up both times that happens and tells them off for being on there. But if you've already finished Haruka's route, it's one of the other unnamed prefects instead. Kanata.
Oh, that's right. Yes. I forgot this detail.
Finishing Haruka's route does not just make her vanish. It makes Kanata vanish too. And there's the question of why. So, as the ending of this route kind of spells out, Haruka, it seems, stayed around in order to help out Kanata herself, in order to grant her wish. Because Kanata was on the bus with them as well. She is part of this dream. But here's the thing about this route. Here's the thing about how this route is written. This route is not written like a pre-refrain route. And I think that is 100% intentional because when we read this route, I do not think this is what happened the first time. I think the original quote-unquote Kanata route was something more like the Rin routes, where they just had to settle.
Huh.
And what we are seeing here is something like the new Kurugaya or Kud routes that get unlocked after Refrain.
Yeah.
This is everyone going through the route again with their Refrain development or closer to it.
There's one thing you said that I don't think is correct, but I cannot remember where it is in the game.
Which one was that?
Kanata is not on the bus. Because the reason Haruka, like, each class is on their own bus. And the reason Haruka decided to ride the bus with Riki's class, even though it's not her class, is because she couldn't stand to be around Kanata. Kanata was on a separate bus that didn't crash.
Is that stated?
I don't think it's in this route, and I don't remember where it is.
It could
very well be in the anime, which would make it not canon to what we're talking about, since Kanata route in the anime is shoved off into OVAs. So don't quote me on this, but I'm pretty sure it's confirmed that Kanata was not on the bus.
I mean, I can see that, but there are a lot of indications that Kanata is aware of the nature of the world. And
right,
if she wasn't involved in that accident, the question is, why would she be? Because I'm
and
on
I
Kasumi
think
route.
That is a kind of a something that they messed up in a way.
If Kyosuke could sneak his way onto the bus, and Haruka could somehow make her way onto the bus, I don't think it's impossible Kanata could get on there either.
I don't think so either. It would be in character for Kanata to, like, as the head prefect, to ride the bus with the school's biggest troublemaker to keep her out of trouble. Like, that's how I would have just straight up presented that. But that doesn't happen, which I do think is one of the problems with this route. I will point this out because, like, it doesn't really fit anywhere else and it kind of relates here. Kanata got a slight redesign after the original Little Busters, because the original Little Busters kind of implied Kanata to be more like Kojiro in that she's kind of a projection of Haruka. Before she was a heroine, before she had her own route and all this extra content. When EX came around and she got a route, her eyes were redesigned to be less cloudy and more like the eyes of the rest of the heroines. And I think this is like a change made specifically to say that this Kanata is real, unlike the Kanata in the original 2007 version of the game. Is that actually true? I have no clue, but it's interesting to think about because, like, she's the only heroine who got a redesign between the two games, and I can't think of any other reason why she would get a redesign.
That is interesting.
Just, you know, food for thought, so to speak.
But yeah, that's what the bad ending kind of brings up. It dives more into her terrible self-image. Like, she imagines herself beating a child version of herself with a rock to suppress her feelings, her heart. And what this bad ending tells me is the reason she acts so bitchy around Riki is that she's putting up a front towards him alone.
Yep.
Because at this point she is stuck with the memories of all the terrible things she did in Haruka's route. She's aware of how futile it was. She's aware of the problems everyone else has that she can't do anything about. And she's basically deciding, I don't deserve to be saved like the rest of them. If Riki can help them, then he should not focus on me. He needs to just focus on them. And even if she wants to be saved on the inside, she's committed to remaining a doll, as she puts it. She's committed to being a side character, or at worst, the villain, if she has to be. And that's where a lot of the conflict of this route comes from. She wants to reach out, but she doesn't think she has the right to.
Yeah, and like this, like getting away from the bad end a little bit, because like this is something that comes up a lot in the backstory, which actually makes up the bulk of this route, and I'll bitch about that later. But like one of the positive things I have to say about it is that I really don't think she knows how. I don't think she knows how to reach out and, like, you know, get help for herself, because, like, she has already committed herself to the role she is playing within Haruka's life. And because, like, you know, if you tell a lie enough times, you're going to start to believe it as the truth yourself. And this is something that Kanata is constantly lying to herself about her nature. We hear like lines from her a lot, where she'll just like have a lot of self-deprecating things that she says, and I think she actually believes them because she has just committed herself to being the role of, you know, the bitch.
Yeah, and like every time she did try to reach out and do something, it backfired on her. Is important to note too.
Yes.
She's associated that act with disaster. She thinks that's exactly what'll happen if she does fully commit to reconnecting with Haruka or becoming friends with Riki.
Or just being nice in general. You know? Like being nice will lead you to situations that will get you beaten at home. You know?
But at the same time, her behavior with everyone else in the common route shows that she can't even commit to that role anymore. She is just constantly torn between these two desires, and that is basically what makes up her wish. She thinks her wish is to just let everyone else be happy, but she does want to be saved from that role.
Yeah. So do we get into a lot of this? I mean, like, there's no better time to talk about it. I think right after, like, you get a bunch of opportunities to get out of the route, but like once Riki really commits himself to going to the dorm committee every day, you get some adorable scenes here. Like, we get the first burger scene. The one I really want to shout out is like Kanata having the cute teacup and won't admit it.
Yes.
And then dumping the tea out the window. Poor Komari.
Yes, she like, becomes collateral damage.
Rip Komari. And then like the next day, tea fell out the window and hit me in the face.
It's so good.
It's like, that's peak Little Buster's comedy. But like, you have some of these scenes, but the problem is that there are so many of them, and a lot of them repeat. Like, my biggest issue with this route in terms of the writing is that everything we learn in Kanata's backstory here is stuff that we already learned in Haruka route. And I would forgive this wholeheartedly if there weren't route locks in this game. But since there are route locks, there is no real reason to rehash all this information for this long of the route. It takes up hours and hours and hours of playtime where you're constantly switching between Riki and Kanata perspectives, and you get Riki slice of life and you get Kanata backstory. I think the Kanata backstory could have been, like, how much we got here should have been cut by like 2/3. There is way too much. And it's all the same information, but it's presented from Kanata's perspective. And I think the reason for it is like, for it's intended to like see how she thought about all these events of the past and that she's not actually a terrible person. But the thing is, if you read Haruka route correctly, which is to listen to everybody and try and discover their good intentions, you already know all this.
Well, yeah, I guess it's my turn, but I'll say...
That's going to be the worst rant I make this episode.
Just
I've got a few more, but this is the worst one.
Just to touch on the slice of life, I really like this because...
The slice of life is not the problem. It's very good.
Yeah, well, I just want to say, like, when you look at it from the perspective of Kanata is actively forcing herself to keep distant from... from Riki,
yeah,
it becomes a lot more entertaining because you see slowly it starts to lift, and you also see a lot of moments where she slips up, where she accidentally acts warmer than she wanted to. There's, I think it's that first teacup scene you mentioned where Riki just goes to make some tea, and he brings up that, the tea he brought was good, and Kanata, without thinking, just says, of course it's good, because it's from Kood. And she just instantly has to catch herself and go back to, like, brooding mode. Because she showed the warmer side of herself. And that is, like, that's brilliant, honestly. Like, seeing that facade slowly crack, seeing Riki slowly figure out how to get around it, seeing the few honest conversations they get to have in between all of that is really good development.
I'm with you, like, there completely.
Like, we, Kanata has to be like a tsundere, right? Just to check.
I don't know.
Or at least a very harsh kudere or something like that.
Yeah, closer to that. She's not aggressive. Like, I really, in the same way that a tsundere is. It's like, I don't know, it's kind of different. She's kind of her own thing.
I'll just say, like, I think she's a great example of that because her reasons for being like that are very developed.
That's
and you
key.
See,
like,
and you see the progress that is made, like, with each little scene.
Yeah.
But, yeah, after that, I should note, it's after all that slice of life ends that we start getting the flashbacks. Like,
not really, though. That's the problem. If it was presented that way, I wouldn't nearly be as angry about it. It's the fact that, like, it continues
it's
through
that...
all of these flashbacks, and it just slows the route down so goddamn much.
I see that, but for one, I accept it because it's not like a lot of lighthearted scenes from that point on once it starts.
Because no, the slice of life does serve a narrative purpose.
It's here. Like you're in the conflict, or at least Riki is aware of the conflict. He's trying to figure out like what he can do. He's talking with Kud and Haruka. He's trying to figure out what's going on. It's between all of that that we start seeing the flashbacks. So
right.
For that, I don't mind it personally. Like, I think that's okay. And then just as far as my opinion on the flashbacks, I mean, I can't like objectively argue with you on this, but
do you feel like you needed them to understand Kanata's character?
I don't, not to understand her, but it made the impact a lot better.
Fair.
For me, because especially on a first read, it is hard to read Haruka's route correctly, even when you try to stay detached like I did, because you are never...
Well, even some fans of it don't do that. Like,
yeah, because it is hard to separate what Kanata really means from her act, and it's just, it's hard to pick apart, and even when you see what is true, for me personally, just being told those things, especially like at the end, isn't quite as impactful as actually seeing them play out.
Sure.
So here's why I don't mind the flashbacks here, even with how long they go on. Because it means we finally get an objective view of what's going on. We see what Haruka got right, but we also see what she got wrong. We see firsthand what Kanata actually went through. We see how she really didn't have any love in her childhood whatsoever. We see she never stopped valuing Haruka that whole time, and we get the story behind their hair ornaments.
Yes, that I'll mention that scene in a second, because I want to like say nice things about Haruka, but I have one not so nice thing to say about Haruka before that. Haruka knew all of this, and yet still treated Kanata very poorly. And I do have a problem with her for that. Because, like, if you know that your pranks and your teasing is potentially contributing to someone else's abuse, I do think that's kind of hard to forgive.
But that's the thing, that's what you even mentioned a bit before. It was the lie becoming reality.
Right.
It was Haruka's like whole impression suddenly like being turned upside down because she thought Kanata really was leading her on, that Kanata wasn't being honest, and the bias just started clouding her entire view of that as the years went on.
Yes, and I do think that's like, I don't know if you weren't on it, but I don't know if you've listened to our Haruka episode.
I have not had the time.
Understandable. One thing that like I did talk about there is that I was like ever so slightly on Kanata's side through that route, and it's because of the information that we learned here that I kind of came to that conclusion, because I do think Haruka's mistakes are a little harder to forgive. Now that I've bitched about her, I'm going to say something really nice about her, because man, that scene where we get the hair ornaments is so good.
That is like the scene that even like cleared up like the point of these flashbacks for me, because it's something we had never heard about before.
Right. Like it's new information, and new information like, you know, changes things.
Yeah, it adds a whole new dimension to that their character designs, that even more so than what Haruka's route gave, because it may have been talked about in the Haruka episode, but I just want to mention it like while we have the chance. Not to sound like Riki, but I want to talk about their hair for a second.
So yeah, let's do it.
Obviously Haruka's hairstyle. you know, they look almost identical if they want to, as Kanata proves. And there's two times throughout the route that we see Haruka without those ornaments, with her hair down. The first time is in her first bad ending, where she is just standing outside the school at night and crying. And the second time is, of course, in the ending, in the good ending, where she takes them off for the photo with Kanata. And I love this because both of these scenes have completely different context for her taking them off. In the bad ending, it's because her whole identity is collapsing, basically. She was trying to define herself from not being like Kanata, but she never got any support outside of that, and she's realized it's futile. She doesn't want to continue like it. And so she's taking them off, even though it makes her look like Kanata, because she just doesn't care anymore. She doesn't know what to do. She's lost. But in the good ending, she takes them off because she wants to immortalize. She wants to embrace her resemblance to Kanata, finally.
I think the origin story behind them could easily have been something Haruka didn't remember, you know? Because, like, the thing is about her childhood is that it was very traumatic, and I think, like, you know, not to downplay what Kanata went through, but I think Kanata did, at the very least, handle it better enough where she's not repressing it nearly as much as Haruka was.
Yeah.
Because, like, you know, again, not trying to downplay what Kanata went through, but Haruka went through the brunt of it, having lost all of those competitions, you know, and, like, having gotten out of it, she, you know, was able to have the chance to heal and kind of leave a lot of that in the past. So it would not surprise me if Haruka did not even remember the origin story of the hair ornaments at all, and it's just something that Kanata knew and was able to hold dear because of how, you know, of course, as we now know, she loves her sister.
Yeah, it is possible, and even if she did remember, like, it's natural she wouldn't think about it because her relatives literally turned that whole thing against her.
Exactly.
Like, they manipulated her. Like, Kanata only gave her two ornaments because she was only taking one for herself. It's to show Kanata will always be number one. And they actively throw out the other hair ornament she had to sell that.
Yeah.
So it's just, that's why I like these scenes. Like, it gives more context. It gives us a clearer view of just what happened, of what they were feeling. And it kind of shows that, you know, their perspectives of everything really did change throughout it all. Like, they had a period where they were united, but slowly, for many reasons, it just fell apart and it devolved into what Haruka remembers. And it honestly made me even more sympathetic to her and Kanata, because it sold me on the theme of the route better, that, you know, they really were trying the entire time, that they weren't being evil at all, that they were trying their hardest.
Good intentions.
Things just went wrong. Even their relatives were finally presented with the details that it was just a few really misguided hardliners that were perpetuating this. That Kanata was trying to change how the family operated, and she basically got blackmailed into stopping. Like, it actually, I wasn't even fully convinced just because of how terrible, like, the relatives were made out to be, but those details actually did sell me on the theme harder, because it shows it was even more complicated than what Haruka knew. And that's why I appreciate these flashbacks, because I do think it gives us a lot more.
I don't think the presentation of that stuff was good.
I mean, presentation, I can't really judge that. All I knew is I read them as they came.
I need the characters to have names. If you're going to, like, try and make them sympathetic, give them a goddamn name. Mm-hmm. Like, that just that's one thing that irritates me in so many stories. And the problem is that this is the, like, this is my, besides the hair sniffing, my biggest problem with Shirakiri as a writer is that, like, and this is an issue I'm going to talk about when we get to Kudwafter Book Club 2. Important characters need to have names, girl. Come on. Like,
In this case, I can forgive that because, you know, we're seeing it from Kanata's perspective, and she's still a kid when this is happening. Like, they're just kind of the force.
Yes.
Like, they're just the uncles. Like, she doesn't really see them as anything besides that.
Yeah, that's fair.
So
I can see that, where that comes from.
Like, you know, if we take on this issue in, like, a straight debate, I don't think I'd win, but just for me personally, I don't mind how these
that's understandable. Like, I just think, I think it's worth bringing up that, like, they do slow the route down a lot. Like, the slice of life and the flashbacks constantly switching with each other take up probably, like, 2/3 of this route, where just the plot doesn't move very much.
I think it's only, like, about 1/3 up to, like, the scene where Kanata finally ends up in the clinic. Yeah, I remember it was a lot of, you know, actual
felt a lot
before
slower
that.
To me, but
and then
okay.
It's, you know, the scene where, you know, the fire breaks out briefly and Kanata's scars are revealed, and then it goes on until Kanata faints in the rain.
Yeah, well, let's get into that, because, like, man, the way that was handled was really freaking good.
Oh, man.
I, like, that's when the route, like, started to pick up again for me, is, like, the way they, you have, like, this completely innocent argument between two other people, and I don't even remember what it was about, but, like, Kanata doing her prefect job really just kind of tried to jump in there and help, and ended up revealing some, like, her darkest secret in a way. And this is something that every, like, you don't notice it until you notice it, but every art of Kanata that even, like, in advertisements for the game, her arms are covered, and, like, even notable key fan artists like Zen always depict her with her arms covered.
Interesting. Yeah, it's a detail that is literally just hidden that entire time. It's something we don't even get a hint about until it's forcefully revealed like that.
Yeah. The way it's revealed is really good.
Yeah, and it just, you know, just as you're learning so much more about Kanata, it exposes you to two other sides. The genuine fury she has over seeing what she thinks is bullying, and the utter panic from having those scars exposed.
Well, it brought back, I can't remember if this is in the first or the second infirmary scene, but it brought back a memory for her where she revealed them to a boy once
before.
Yeah, That's the second one. Okay, so I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit.
I guess, do we want to jump right to the first infirmary scene then, since, like I said, all those flashbacks take place before that?
Yeah, let's do it.
So, yeah, this first infirmary scene is, like, the initial emotional climax of the route to me, because it's, like, it's basically what everything had been building up to before. Kanata finally overworks herself to the point that she faints, and now everyone is having to come together for her. Haruka has to talk with Kud, has a really sweet talk with Kud, where they just kind of talk about what they want to do, what they think they can do. And finally, Riki, who has, you know, been devoting so much time to getting to learn Kanata, to seeing, trying to learn what she actually wants, just straight up tells her, you can't keep being like this, you need to accept the arms that everyone else is extending to you. Like, you can't just stand on the sidelines.
I love Ricky in this scene.
Yes. He is fantastic.
This is some peak Ricky for me. Because, like, and it's very reminiscent to how he treats Haruka with, and also Rin in a way, with his, I'm going to be there for you, but you need to make a change too.
Yes.
Which is exactly, you know, what I love about him as a protagonist in this story.
And I think this is about the time where I really want to say what I meant by everything, by this being like a post-refrain mindset.
Yeah.
I do not believe that the Ricky from before refrain would be able to do this. I don't think he'd be able to get this far. And there's so many reasons. But I think, you know,
I wonder if you're going to say what I'm about to say, but go ahead.
Oh, I mean, I already mentioned like the difficulty he has with Kanata normally. But there's a lot more than just that, because we have to consider Ricky is basically making an entire other like network of friends with his work in this route. The subplot of the club room doesn't really come up once he really gets immersed in it, but he still does it. It becomes a new routine for him. Like, Ah-chan, you know, I don't know if she's been mentioned before, Ah-chan gets most of her screen time in this round, and we finally get to see the sides of her when she isn't just working. She's a playful person. She's really charming, actually. She has, like,
real
some sort of relationship with Kyosuke that we don't know, but she refers to him very affectionately, and we saw some of that in, you know, whenever she showed up before that, but she's a genuine supporting character in this. And that is like making friends like that outside the Little Busters. I do not think Ricky would be able to do that like this. Mio, he can only get as far with because he immediately cottons on that she reminds him of his past self. And even once he brings her into the fold, you know, he doesn't have to keep up with it because the rest of the Little Busters are there with her. But Kanata, she's not a solo effort, but everyone else, but, you know, every other part of this dorm committee is for him. And yet he still goes along with it for his own sake. And that, I think, is just continuing his development from refrain. That's what I think these post-refrain routes really represent. It's, he can't, you know, even if he got his happy ending, he can't just be content with them forever. He's lost his fear of making new connections. And now he's using that. He's befriending people where his relationships with them were basically defined by their relationships with his friends. And in a meta way, I think Saya represents befriending entirely new people as well.
Yes. So here's, you kind of got into what I wanted to say here, but I'll just, like, about Kanata herself, she is like the biggest challenge of a heroine. You know, like, she's antisocial, she's rude, and she, like you mentioned earlier, actively pushes Ricky away. This is a much more difficult heroine for him to be able to do something for than anyone else in this game. And, like, I'm gonna bring it back to Komari here. Kanata is the kind of person who needs the happiness spiral. You know, like, we talked in the Haruka route episode about how, like, the happiness spiral can kind of work in reverse. Where it's just hate begets more hate, begets more hate, begets more hate. And, like, how Riki and Haruka needed to work to turn this around. Well, now it's the same kind of thing, but this time it's to help Kanata, because, like, she really needs it. She really needs someone to show her that level of positivity.
Yeah, and it is really, like, a brilliant, like, reversal in theme. Like, that's how I see this route. It is very connected to Harka's route, like, inherently. I pair these together now.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, I let them feed off each other, and it's improved my opinion of both of them, actually.
Wow, that's great.
It's basically formed one complete story. Like, we've seen Haruka, you know, after a lot of struggles, you know, have her wish granted. And then we go, but something was left behind. There's still Kanata. Like, as happy as that ending was, she's lost it, and she still has so many other issues that haven't been resolved. And now they're going back for her. Haruka is making an effort to reach out, and she's discovering that people really do want to be her friends. They really are there for her. Like, I'll go back to this in the climax, but it's just so cathartic, I guess would be the word, after how troubling Harka's route is.
Yeah, so that's, you know, that's kind of the midsection. Like, we have the second infirmary scene too. Do we have anything else to get into before that? Like, I have one. Kanata quitting all her activities.
Yes.
Like, and you know, making decisions for herself for once in her life, which is just, you know, part of, like, becoming happy is, you know, sometimes you have to make decisions that, you know, might be sacrificial in some ways, but, like, sometimes, like, how many of us have felt relief when we just, like, got rid of one extra thing that was taking up so much time and not actually helping our case? I think being a prefect was that for Kanata, and to a slightly lesser extent the Kendo Club too.
Yes,
you know, just removing those and just sticking to, you know, helping herself and the dorm committee, and those are just her two things that she is focusing her time on, I think just allowed her to, you know, not be so perpetually stressed all the time.
Yes, Ah-chan even says, like, Kanata's work started with the dorm committee, but then she started picking up those other responsibilities.
Right.
She started with what she wanted to do, but then it just started getting overwhelming. She never wanted to do kendo. It was just something her relatives forced on her.
Right.
And being a prefect was probably technically her choice, but I think that was partly because she knew she could play the role of, like, the hard ass everyone hates the best.
And also because it was an easy way for her to keep an eye on Haruka, because if Haruka acted out in school, then Kanata was presumably getting beaten at home.
Yes, that too. And it's just, yeah, we just get a much calmer Kanata after all that. If you so choose, she even, you know, enters a relationship with Riki, which I want to say on this, it might seem unconvincing just taking the route by itself, but I think the reason this comes about on her end is because of just basically built up feelings from her other experiences with him. Like, she knows he's a good person. I think she even admires him a little.
Yeah.
And seeing him just sincerely reach out to her like that, I think pretty convincingly leads to feelings on her end as well.
This is one of the better romances in this game, I think. Like, I think this is, like, a really convincing romance, personally.
I do too, and it's adorable seeing just how much of a mess she becomes around him after it.
Yeah, like, man, she's really freaking cute.
She is adorable. That second burger scene where it's like she constantly embarrasses herself.
Oh yeah. Also, like, this is a really random Lucci thing, but if I don't talk about it now, where else am I going to?
Oh,
something
boy.
About women remaking sandwiches served to them is just immensely attractive. I have no idea why. But, like, how she'll, like, disassemble the burger and reassemble it is just really cute. I don't know why I like this, but I do.
This is maybe the most specific kink I've ever heard you express.
I mean, and I've got some weirdly specific ones too.
Yes, so that's saying something.
Yes. But it's, I don't know, where else am I going to talk about it?
Oh, and yeah, while we're on this subject of like the date, I also want to bring up the movie. Because early in the route, you know, Ah-chan gives Riki like a choice of gifts for helping out. It's, do you want a meal ticket, which just changes like a scene after that a bit, or do you want a movie ticket, which if you choose the movie ticket,
yes.
Yeah, finally cashes out here. He goes to see a fantasy movie with Kanata, and like it's a nice little scene by itself where they just discuss like what it was about and they see like their differences in interpretation. But why I find this interesting is because of what the story of the movie is about. It's a boy trapped in a room with a but supposedly a cat inside of a box that may or may not be real. And they're stuck there because of a bunch of poison gas outside. And the movie ends with the cat telling the boy, "You can go outside and survive, but you shouldn't take me with you." And whilst they're discussing that, Riki wonders why the boy left the cat there, and Kanata, like, accepts it because the cat asked him to. But Riki says, "I would have taken the cat with me." And why I find this interesting is that this is literally the plot to Refrain.
What? Okay.
This is like my biggest proof that this route, or at least this interpretation of the route, has to be after Refrain. Because him giving such a clear answer to that situation.
Yeah, it does make sense.
And also, there's a specific theme throughout the routes of Little Busters of Riki saying, "I wish these days would go on forever."
Right.
Every pre-refrain route, he mentions it in some way. And he thinks about it in this route too. And several other people do as well. Kengo does, Kanata does, Haruka does. But every time it comes up, they add a very specific thing after it. That it's an impossible dream. They have that wish, but they acknowledge it can't happen. Even Kengo, who fought so hard to keep it going, acknowledges that as much as he wishes it, it won't ever happen. And that is like such a wide change in mentality that I think has to come from Refrain. They may not all remember it specifically. Like, that is the weird nature of these post-refrain endings, like in Kud and Kurugaya. But I think that mentality is still influencing them like that.
I can totally see this. That one, I will admit, I did not even consider. Like, because the movie is an optional choice.
Yes.
You know, like, it's something that's very easy to just completely miss. And I think most people probably pick the other one, because like it's like one of the biggest memes in the Little Busters community is the Kanata Borger. So like it's very easy to see like, oh, food, that must be how I get the Borger CG without realizing you can get it anyway. So that probably gets missed a lot. Admittedly, I did pick the movie this time because I know you get the Borger CG anyway. And I did not put that together. That's really clever, though. That's cool.
I should say, I finished this route yesterday, and like this is proof of how hard I was having to analyze everything and put it together that I even like made that connection.
Yes. Yeah.
But I think with that in mind, it's actually like such a clever optional scene that like reminds you that you haven't gone back in time, that you are, in a way, these characters have still moved forward. And that's actually why I love, you know, the idea of these routes. why they're after a frame.
Content, yeah.
Because, you know, they may be placed wherever, but it doesn't feel like that you've regressed. It feels like there's a feeling, there's a reason for them to be here instead of earlier.
Fair. Yeah, I can get behind that. I don't really have anything to add to it. That's just cool, but there's that, and then yeah, Scout got the big brain, MP says in chat for real. Like, the EX routes kind of demand that from you, because, like, they are really complicated, just in terms of, like, their lore and stuff, and it's just, I don't know. Worth looking into for sure.
I'm glad I'm reading this route like in the present day, because if this were a year or two ago, I would have struggled so hard with things like this. Like, it's not self-deprecation for me to say I struggled with picking up thematic stuff like this for a while, but I think ever since I joined the server, I've slowly been getting better and better, and now I'm here making connections, like Riki being a big hitter in baseball is his inner strength.
In probably, I would say, the thematically the second most complicated keywork. Like, Summer Pockets, I think, gets crazier than this one, but I don't think any other one does. Maybe Clannad. Clannad is a lot more obvious about its themes, though. So, like, you're like taking on one of the really hard ones right now.
I'm impressed at how far
especially the EX routes.
Oh, you know, since I mentioned, actually, just one more thing about the big hitter, since I mentioned that
brought
again.
Brought it up right now, yeah.
And I brought it up in Mio's episode. You know, him meeting Mio starts with him hitting a really bad foul ball that ends up hitting her in the courtyard.
I think that's really funny, by the way.
It is. And then his, you know, his continued interactions with him are him wanting to reach out to her and help her, like the little busters did with him. His entire relationship with Mio is founded on his inner strength.
Yeah, it's, oh man, this game is good.
from the physical strength to the emotional strength, and I love that.
It's putting the two of them together, you know, like using one to as an allegory for the other and vice versa, which is just, you know, very in character for Kyosuke, since he is the one calling the shots for the majority of the game.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we have that. We have the second infirmary scene. Side note, this is where the H scene happens, and it's actually a weirdly good one if you're reading Ecstasy Edition. So I recommend it.
It's also extremely obvious, but...
Yeah, like, it is not hard to figure out, and it's because, like, this is one of the rare, like, non-thematically important H scenes that is actually really well-placed.
Does it happen before or after she tells her story about the scars?
Immediately after.
Okay, yeah, actually, I'll agree with that in that case, but because she talks about how bad they are, because she talks about a boy who said he had liked her for a long time, rejecting her after getting a glimpse of those bullying scars, and her, you know, admitting her fear that Riki or anyone else kind to her would repeat that. That's where her anxiety
comes
from.
And it just doesn't happen. And it's great.
Riki says something great here. If I would have done something like that, I would have said it when I first saw them.
Yeah, that's a really good line, because, like, he, you know, when Kanata has her initial meltdown, like, he needs the help of the other little busters to kind of, like, get her to calm down a little bit, but to his credit, he doesn't act surprised or admonishing or anything. He just legitimately wants to help, and he asks for the others because he doesn't really know how at first, but he's still, you know, like, treats Kanata with a level of respect that she deserves.
it is just so good. That this is why I say it's the strong Riki in this round.
Yeah. And, definitely.
And shortly after this, unfortunately, comes up the other climax. And this is where I lean in even more heavily to Kanata being part of the dream, because they're nearing the school trip. Ah-chan even brings it up, and Kanata reacts in an absolutely not very visibly, but she gets the saddest sprite when that happens. Like, she knows something is going on, and there's even a very brief switch to her perspective where she reflects, oh, it's the school trip already. And you can just tell she needs to make something happen.
In the dream world, like, in every route that isn't Kurgaya, it ends at before the school trip happens. You know, like,
yes.
If you make it up to the school trip, that is, like, where the world is going to reset again, unless Kurgaya is, like, trying to, like, maintain a stranglehold on it. So, like, Kanata I don't think Kanata has the strength to try and do that. So all she could do is just kind of act depressed about it. And we cut to her and Haruka interacting with each other in the real world, presumably after Haruka wakes up in the hospital.
And oh, like, you're skipping straight to that.
Oh, I won't if you have something else.
No, yeah, I still have plenty to say, because...
Okay.
Yeah, here is where Kanata makes her final decision, or what she thinks is her final decision. She is going to leave the school early and go with the Futakis to her fate, basically.
Oh, this.
She actively...
I don't like this sequence.
Okay, let me say. She actively forces this situation because she thinks her wish has been granted at this point. She's had her happiness. She's almost made up with her sister. She's had these friends, and she's decided, you know, that's it. That's done. That was her wish. And now Riki needs to move on. He needs to help everyone else. And so, you know, she goes to be taken away. And Riki and everyone else sees this, and they decide, no, you're not going to run away at the very end. And this is another thing that is very post-refrain, because there is no Riki, you are on your own moment in this route. When this climax happens, everyone contributes. Even Kyosuke. Kyosuke actively shows up for it. He does not try to force, you know, Riki to solve it himself like he would in another route. They have a completely different mentality to this, and it's because of them coming together with this mentality that I think the good ending can even be achieved, because they're showing once and for all she has a place here. She has people who truly, truly respect her and want her to be here. She can't keep running away if she doesn't truly want this in her heart. And I really like this. I really love it. It's like, it really is like one of my favorite, like, potential, you know, climaxes to this that I could see, because it shows she has achieved, you know, turning over a new leaf. She has made her impact. And everyone is paying her back for that.
To this. I need to raise a critique to this, because, like, I kind of agree with what you're getting at here, but I actually think this entire decision that Kanata makes, if anything, weakens her character. It almost feels like she's afraid of having her happy ending, so she kind of, like, makes one last attempt to say, okay, I had my fun, now I'm gonna go back to what I should be doing, instead of, you know, like, actually taking the things she learned and applying them. The fact that this happens in addition to the one in the real world is just completely redundant, and the first one makes Kanata a weaker character. I think this entire sequence should have just been completely left out.
I don't think
it adds anything.
I don't agree because, you know, she does still make that decision, but once she sees what everyone is doing for her, she immediately admits her true feelings, that she does want to stay here. And that's when her wish is finally granted.
But why? But this all literally happens in the real world too. What happens
because,
after they wake up from the dream?
Because they make a promise about it.
The last thing
she says to Riki is, "If I asked you to run away with me, would you do it?" And he says yes. And you know, after that, the world finally comes to its end, or at least this loop, this dream comes to its end for Haruka and Kanata. They finally officially make up, and we're returned to the real world.
Yeah, so I started to mention it earlier. We have this entire sequence where Haruka's presumably waking up in the hospital. I need to reread this sequence with the idea that Kanata might have been on the bus. Because, like, if she was, she was definitely significantly less injured. Than Haruka was. But I don't know. I'm not... I really need to research this because I think that does change things.
It's all but said, like, Haruka wakes up to someone watching over her.
Well, that makes sense in both contexts because, like, if Haruka was in the hospital and Kanata was not because she wasn't on the bus, then Kanata would be worried about her sister because, as we know now, Kanata has always had good intentions and always loved her sister. I would rush to the hospital too to go see her.
Yeah, like it works regardless of intentions, but I can see like Kanata either being less injured or like probably even forcing herself to, you know,
also plausible
before she's fully recovered just to make sure that Haruka is okay.
Yeah, which would be very much in character for her as well.
And it's just, like, this, you know, the scene of them making up in Haruka's route is already really good. But I love this sequence so much. Like, this is what completely made the route for me. Seeing them continue to make up. Seeing the, you know, the promise, you know, that they didn't lose it. The way that their making up was reduced to, like, two lines in refrain. I was happy to see it mentioned, but I kind of wasn't satisfied that she didn't even get to show up. So getting to see that here, getting to know that, you know, it didn't get lost with the disappearance of the real world, that they aren't, you know, it wasn't just the accident that made them make up, that they both came to this decision because of their experiences. I really like that. That is a fantastic, like, cap off to the whole subplot.
I can definitely get behind that, yeah. I personally was plenty convinced by the little bit I saw in Refrain, just because of how drastically different it was from, like, the early hours of Haruka's route, where we see, like, how, you know, hateful they were toward each other. But see, you know, I'll always be happy with more. More is good.
Yeah, it's like they mention in Refrain that they still, like, squabble. But through this,
which is true in the early hours of this route as well. We see, like, Kanata helping her cook, but she's still like, "What the heck are you doing, girl? You're messing up all the time."
And like, even in the real world after this sequence, like, they aren't just, like, totally getting along. They have some silly conversations that we see, you know,
but that's normal. It still feels good intentioned.
We see it's still good intentioned. It's just sisterly.
Siblings argue.
Yes,
okay.
It's just that clash of personalities.
Yeah, exactly.
Grief.
Yeah. All right. Let's get into the real world climax because we can't put it off anymore. It is one of the dumbest things that happens in this game, and I would not have it any other way. It's me so too. Stupid, but it's really funny.
It is the most, like, common route feeling ending to a route ever, and I think that's awesome because it, you know, it even further falls up on the pre-refrain, the post-refrain stuff. Like, this is something Riki and Haruka put together. It's a plan that involves everyone. Once again, everyone is here for Kanata. Yeah. They are all keeping their promise. They're showing they aren't going to forget her, that they aren't going to leave her, that she deserves her happy ending. And they're going to do it no matter how dumb they have to act.
Yeah. I have to say it. Shout outs to how this is done in the anime. Like, the Sasami and Kanata routes in the anime are relegated to 2 episodes each. They're OVAs in the EX season. And they are not super well presented in general, but this scene was done so well. Everyone gets their own, like, new outfits for this scene. And it's just one of the funniest things that the Little Busters anime has to offer.
It's just, it is like a
Kud has a mustache. You have to see it, Scout. Like,
what?
Yeah, Kud has a mustache.
Oh yeah, speaking of, shout outs to the infamous muscle celebration scene.
Oh yeah, like, oh, we'll be getting into that next week when we talk about the true ending of Little Busters.
But
so.
Let's just say there's, like, stickers and gifs of it. I never once believed it was actually real.
And in the game, yeah.
Like, I was so shocked, but it's,
it's one of the things that, like, caused Masakud shipping to happen.
I see, like, in the EX routes, like, Masato and Kud actually get associated a bit more than, you know, in the base game. Like, in Sasami's route, from what I saw, there's Masato's mysterious muscle drink. She's the only one who supports it, and she tries it, and, like, it doesn't work out, but they're, you know, they're getting along.
It's one of the weirdest ships in this fandom, but, like, the interactions do kind of warrant it a little bit, so I support it.
It's so dumb, I think I support it, too. Like, it's actually... Yeah. Seeing someone who takes Masato seriously is actually really cute.
Yeah, for real.
Just one more thing. Even the lead up to that scene is kind of interesting because it comes from Riki observing he's starting to build up muscle. And that's just another thing. He's being stronger than he was before. That's another thing that makes me say it's everyone post-refrain. Like, this is just not the same Riki as before. And I think it's awesome. I think it's an awesome look at him.
Yeah. He is in this entire ending sequence, we see that, like, a lot of the things he learned came to be in the real world, and, like, obviously we see that at the very end of Refrain when he's pulling everyone off the bus, but, like, we get to see that, like, it went even beyond that, too. You know, like, he's still the, you know, amazingly strong person that he is, doing dumb shit after it's all over, too. You know, like, the world, the story doesn't end. Riki's story doesn't end when everyone's out of the hospital. You know, he's still got a lot of life left to live, and he's going to do a lot more dumb shit like this.
Yeah, he's embraced his role as the heart of the Little Busters.
Exactly.
Like, they look at Yosuke for what dumb shit they're going to do, but when it comes to something serious like this, he will lead the charge all the way.
Really? Yep, exactly. So, that's Kanata route as a whole. Like, the two ending thing is not done as, and, like, this is a bit of a hype moment for you, it's not as interesting here as it is for Sasami. It's basically just, do you want a romance ending or a not romance ending?
I didn't bother with the other ending. I was satisfied with the romance.
They are negligible in terms of differences, but for you, when you're doing sasami, I think you should get both.
All right.
Because they have some significant differences that Platy and I talked about last week, and Nari has a whole thing about them as well.
Okay, I'll keep that in mind then, but yep. I guess it's time for rankings.
Yes. So I'll go first. I gave this route a 7. And, like, I think it's thematically pretty cool, but it's not as big of an emotional hit as Sasami's for me. And the writing really holds it back. There's a lot of stuff in here that it just doesn't need to be here. This could have been trimmed down and it would have had a stronger impact because I wasn't feeling like I was constantly fighting to get to the next thing. Like, this route had a lot of, not just a lot of potential, but also it needed to be good because of how many people play the game and are not instantly sold on the heroine. And if you're not instantly sold on the heroine, there are a good number of people who read this route and are like, yeah, I'm still not sold on the heroine. And I think that's a pretty big problem when you have a character who's so controversial. So this is what I had to apologize to Platy about. I think this is the weakest route in the game, but I still think it's good, and I still love Kanata. I think she deserves all the happiness in the world, and she's just a beautiful, beautiful human.
All right, totally fair. As, you know, my passionate defense throughout this episode has indicated, I think of it quite a bit better than that. Reasonably, it's probably, like, closer to an 8.5 for me, but I'm going to round it up to a 9.
Bless.
I really like this route. I will happily be its like biggest defender if I have to be, because I didn't like Kanata before. I was interested in her, but the combination of what I saw here with, you know, in Kud's route and here genuinely made me fall in love with her too. I love Haruka too. They're about equal for me, but I just love both of them. I love their story. It really sold me on Kanata, on her good points, on how enjoyable she is to be around, that she deserves this happy ending. And like I said, it actually made me appreciate Haruka's route more too. Like, it's me, like, correlating them so closely like that, and just, you know, partly just my tolerance for pacing and stuff that kept any writing issues from really bothering me. Like, I just really enjoyed this. I liked this as, like, a more low-key alternative to the stream of stuff that happens in Haruka's route, is how I'll put it.
Yeah, that I can appreciate that for sure, and answering some of the things that were, you know, left up as questions there.
Like, just, you know, seeing them get their, like, definitive happy endings, seeing them, like, proclaim once and for all that they don't need to believe in evil intentions in this world, seeing that there was this tragic story, like, more than even they remembered, but throughout it all, Kanata never stopped caring, truly. I don't know, it just got to me. Like, that scene before they go to the real world where they're making up, that got tears out of me.
That, like, is more than one just of a couple. Peaks, yeah.
And that is not an easy thing, even for little busters. There's only been a handful of routes that have done that so far. So I just really connected with this story.
Yeah, so that's Kanata route for you. I'm not going to mention the poll now because, like, I made it really late, and so we'll mention it next week, but we did not mention Sasami's poll last week, and Platy just came in to tell us it got a solid 9 from everyone, which is really cool. The EX routes are generally pretty well loved. I'm one of the bigger critics of them here, so it's nice to see some love for these routes and to learn some new things about them, because I've been learning a lot of new things throughout
if my
the post game book club,
if my obsessive like analysis of this route has like granted anyone a new perspective on it, I will be satisfied.
You did your job completely. I think you did.
Like I think I'm on track to be one of the bigger proponents for the EX routes too.
Yeah.
If I liked this one this much, and I'm still so excited to see what goes on the Cat Queen route.
If you like this one, it gets it. You're gonna like all three, I think.
I was looking forward to these for a long time, and it's looking like it's gonna pay off.
Yeah, it'll be great. So next week will be our last week of the Little Busters Book Club. We will be talking about Saya Route, all of its endings, and also Muscle Sensation will be the topics for next week, and also we will be doing all of the giveaways. So hosts will be some combination of me, Scout, Haipa, and or Nari. It's still up in the air, so show up for whoever shows up on Saya Route.
One more note I just want to say, like,
lay it on us.
Me initially being on this episode was like me volunteering, basically, because the host situation was a bit questionable.
We weren't sure who was going to be here for this one.
Like, straight up, every guest spot for these episodes had been filled out, like, at the start of the book club.
Except for this one.
Yes, except Kanata. Kanata stayed conspicuously empty. And, like, you said, like, before this that you wanted me on this episode, like, specifically, even before I finished the route. Like, was there a reason for that?
What you said about Haruka's route.
Okay. Yeah.
After we talked about Haruka's route, I'm like, I think you're going to end up a Kanata route fan, and I think this is the one I want you on for.
Yeah, you guessed correctly. Like, I was holding out some hope. I wasn't totally convinced, but as soon as I finished this, I was like, if I hadn't already volunteered to guest for this episode, I would have asked for it immediately.
I amazing.
Fully converted. I love Kanata. She is not best girl, that's still Mio, but she's very up there.
Amazing. All right, so see you all next week, and that's a wrap. Good night, everyone.
See you all next time.